Yeah, welcome to the channel. This is Anaz. I am going to be doing an impression, pretty much showering love on this series here, To Your Eternity. I read this a while back and up to about volume 7, but then the other day I just picked it up on a whim, really, and I started reading this marvelous series. And upon rereading it, there were some things that I picked up, some of the techniques that Yoshitoku Omai, I'm probably butchering her name there, some of the techniques and some of the way that the direction that the story was going, kind of that foresight, that hindsight, that you know, on a reread, some of that made me appreciate the series a little bit more, and kind of just, I don't know, like it elevated the series even more. It was already in my top favorites, but now it's like I'm seeing the geniusness behind the story and the kind of how it's progressing. Pretty much this first volume in itself is kind of like a. What it contemplates and what it holds is together, is so cool. So even the first chapter itself, Fushi, our main character. So if you're not familiar with the series, it's kind of the premise is that there's an orb that can take the form of other objects, or if it sees a person or a being or an animal die, if it witnesses it, it can take that form and it can stimulate. So the orb can stimulate. So it's cast onto Earth. It originally becomes a wolf, and then the wolf encounters this, you know, boy in the middle of nowhere, and it learns from the boy. It just watch, observes the boy, and takes in the experience, some of the wishes, some of the ambition that boy had, and some of his dreams, and kind of the suffering, and the futility and the way he was living. All that, I think, it absorbs, and then eventually, once the boy succumbs to death, it takes the form and becomes that boy to kind of fulfill, in a way, there is like this DNA embedded in him about the memory and maybe the ambition or even the dreams that the boy has. Now the being is gonna maybe perhaps go out and explore and maybe succeed where the boy failed. And some of the, like, you know, the perks that the orb has is that it can die and then regenerate, and then dies, then regenerates, then dies, and all the pain and all that experience in the regeneration is becoming a little bit more invisible. It's taking in more pain, more emotions. And so now the cool thing that I really liked about this was the subtlety and the way that all that, those, you know, qualities were reinforced through the paneling and some of the emotions. And, you know, in the beginning with the boy, some of the struggles and how that is showing to us as readers. And I really appreciated that. And in the first, like, I might have missed that on my first read, so I really appreciated that. So in the art and it's the use of the panel and the space, there's nothing like all the details in here, hold a significance. So it adds a layer to the story, and that's kind of the cool part. The other characters I really enjoyed that was introduced later on is March, and also her significance to this being, this orb. And later on, even the other characters that encounters in the Panaya village, or the village that the first, you know, civilization or village that he encounters, I'm calling it, but at this point it's a human being. So the orb Fushi, who we later is going to be the later the name. Some of that village and kind of the culture that and the tradition, and one of the traditions that is the ritual where they sacrifice young kids, that you know. So it just shows, in a way, it kind of shows subtly some of the cruelties, some of the suffering that's going on in this world. So I just was enthralled and engulfed in experiencing this all over again. So yeah, I like that aspect of the story. And by volume 2, some of the characters, you know, so it's not only about Fushi, but even March and the other two characters, Piranha, Hayase, and all of these characters later are going to have they're going to be very significant. And the coolest thing that I kind of picked out on this is that I was confused later on in like volume 7, but some of these characters now, some of the things that they do, or some of the events that occurs in here, have a consequence later on, so that it comes back on volume 7 or 6. And it's just cool to see the setup now in retrospect. So that, you know, that's why I'm just like right here, and this was like a prompt of gushing over this series, and I would definitely recommend this. So I'm just rereading it for the sake of rereading, and just kind of to fill in the gap and re-emerge myself in the story that's being told. I think the arc ends at up to volume 12, and then there's a new arc that begins after that. But the journey, man, there's just suffering, a lot of suffering, and the subtlety and the emotions. And it's, yeah, by the end of this, we get to kind of find out as to why, maybe the, some of the motive behind why the orb was cast on Earth, and kind of maybe the person behind that's pulling the strings in a sense. But by the by this, like, there was an arc, you know. So our orb has become an infant and has become maybe perhaps an adolescent as far as the stages that he's you know, he's in as a human being. It's just cool. I can't wait to read the third volume. I'm kind of aware, so it's kind of like a reread. But this is pretty much me just showering praise on the series. Hopefully the anime is gonna be cool. I can't wait to watch it. I think it's kind of, I don't know what channel it's coming on, but yeah, cool. To Your Eternity. That's that. Let me know if you guys enjoyed the series. What are your thoughts? If you like the video, please leave a like, comment, and just, yeah, all in all, it's a cool series. Thanks for watching, and peace.